So, good morning. My name is Panagiotis Simeonidis. Thank you for being here in the tutorial for matrix and tensor decomposition in recommender systems. Here comes the outline of the presentation. It consists of two parts. The first part has to do with matrices, matrix decomposition, whereas the second part has to do with tensor decomposition. Most of the material in this presentation comes from my book, which will be very soon published from Springer. The name is the same with the this tutorial name, Matrix and Tensor Factorization Techniques for Recommender Systems. Recommender systems help businesses to increase their sales through cross-selling and ad revenues. So we have Amazon that sells more than 30% of product sales come from recommendations. We have the Netflix with 66% of the movies rented are recommended. And we have also Google with 38% more click-through click-through rates, which are generated from recommendation in Google News. Recommenders help businesses to increase their diversity of products they sell and get high customers retention. The recommenders focus on the long tail of this green curve. They want to cover the special needs that a customer has, and not only for the popular items. Moreover, the accuracy of recommendation can gain the customer's retention, and justifiable recommendation increase the transparency of and the credibility of the system. Here we can see an example of recommendation. Customers who bought this item also bought. This is Amazon site, which is one of the first companies that implemented recommendations, incorporated recommendations. We can see also an example of nearest neighbor style of recommendation, which is based on collaborative filtering. Customers who bought item X also bought item Y, X, etc. The main structure of collaborative filtering algorithms consists of two stages. The first is the construction of the user-user neighborhood, whereas the second is the production, the construction of a ranked product list. This is the case for the user-based CF recommender system. We have to notice that there is also the construction of the item-based CF algorithm, where there we have the construction of the item-based neighborhood. Of course, there are several challenges for recommender systems. For example, what kind of similarity measure are we going to use? The cosine similarity, the Pearson correlation, the neighborhood size, the k nearest neighbor, the data sparsity, the existence of missing values, the fact that 99% of data are missing most of the times eliminates more standard prediction methods. Of course, there are also countless factors that may affect a preference or a rating. The rater's mood, the item bias, and the size of data may stretch memory limits of standard personal computers. Moreover, there is a possibly large imbalance in training and test data. Here we can see an example of a user item recommender system where it presents a weighted user movie bipartite graph where each end connects a user and a movie. And it has a weight that indicates the degree of preference of a user over this movie in the rating scale 0 to 5. Here, for reasons of clarity, we present only the positive ratings above 4, ratings above 4. So let's assume that in our running example, we want to predict the rating of user 4 on movie X-Men. To show this assumption, we use it a dotted line for the edge of that connects user 4 with movie 4, and the possible rating is shown with a question mark. The challenge of a recommender system is to correctly predict the rating that a rating for those items that the user has not rated at all. In our example, with a user item rating matrix A, which is shown on the right side of the slide, we can represent the ratings of a user with a set of movies. This toy example will be used throughout all this tutorial. And as shown, the example dataset is split in two parts, the training set, the above table, and the test set. We have the user U4. So in this slide, we try to provide a recommendation to a user, to user 4 again, by exploiting also his friendship network. The first layer contains the friendship network among users, whereas the second layer shows the movies which are rated only positively by users. So in this case, our recommender's task is again to provide to user 4 to predict a rating on movie X-Men. As we can see, user 4 is connected with user 2. So based on the theory of homophily, which claims that friends may share common interests, we cannot predict a high rating for user 4 on the X movie, since user 2 doesn't like this movie, as shown in the previous slide. So this simple example shows how the social network could affect and leverage the ability of recommendations. This graph shows a hypothetical layout of movies in two dimensions. In the example, the horizontal dimension contrasts movies that males like from movies that females like, while the vertical dimension contrasts war movies from romance movies. To predict a user's rating over a movie, we can compute the dot product of the movies and the user's coordinates, X and Y, on the graph. So this figure shows how users may fall in the two dimensions. For example, we would expect user 3, the red one, to love Casablanca, to hate the King's Speech, and to rate Amelie about average. Please notice that some movies like Taken or users like user 4, the green one, would be characterized as fairly neutral on these two dimensions. In a real application of matrix factorization, an algorithm would determine an input, so it might not be easy to label the axis. So feel free to disagree with my placement of these movies. So for some problem scenarios, matrix factorization is not adequate. Here comes the tensor factorization, which can handle effectively higher order problem scenarios. For example, as shown in this slide, users can visit the location in a real world and can provide geotagged information, content, comments, photos, etc. In particular, this figure presents three layers. The first is the user, the second the location layer, and the third the content layer. It is obvious that someone can exploit information from each layer independently to leverage the accuracy of recommendations. However, we could also exploit the ternary relation between all these participating entities, which can be easily handled with the representation of a tensor. So let's start with matrices. Matrices factorization attracted a lot of researchers' attention after the Netflix Prize. The goal was there to improve on Netflix algorithm movie recommender system. So the matrix factorization method went quite well there. As we can see, the main method that was very powerful in this contest was the known regularized SVD. SVD allowed anyone to approach the early leader, leaders of the leaderboard easily. It was very efficient, the SVD, and it was easy to program. Moreover, it could be very easily inserted and incorporated inside the model additional features. For example, here we have the SVD++ proposed from by Koren, Yekuda Koren, which is incorporates the also information about what movies are rated, if a movie is rated or not, which is known as implicit feedback. Moreover, we could insert into our model temporal effects, like the well-known algorithm timeSVD, which is also proposed by Yekuda Koren, and adds temporal effect in the model. The RMSE score goes even lower when we add neighborhood effects with user biases and with user factors. So, as you can see, matrix factorization is a very powerful tool where we can add and incorporate additional features. Of course, matrix decomposition is not a new history. It has more than 100 years that has been developed in other areas, mostly in statistics. And by using the theory of linear algebra, we can exploit relations among data, and based on the algorithms that we use, we can reveal latent associations among data. So there are several matrix decomposition methods, such as the SVD, the UV, the CURE, the NMF, etc. Let's see some basic definitions and properties in linear algebra, just in case that you don't remember, and we will see after in this tutorial. So the identity matrix has ones in the main diagonal and zeros elsewhere. We have the transpose of the matrix, which is the reverse of the rows. The rows become columns. The inverse of a matrix, which is defined by the product of A and the A inverse is the identity matrix. Of course, if no inverse exists, then the matrix is called singular or non-invertible. We have the orthogonal matrix, which is a square matrix with real entries, whose columns are orthogonal unit vectors. And a matrix Q is orthogonal if its transpose is equal to its inverse. The rank of a matrix is the number of non-independent rows and columns. And the Frobenius norm is the matrix which is given from this formula. We will start with eigen decomposition. For the basic decomposition method, so in linear algebra, to apply a method on a matrix, the matrix should be not only square but also diagonalizable. And the eigen decomposition is a factorization of a matrix A into its eigenvalues and the eigenvectors of A, which are used to represent this matrix. In case that the rank R of a matrix A is equal to its dimension n, then matrix A can be factorized as follows. Another method which is used for decomposition is known as non-negative matrix factorization. In the following three slides, we will discuss the NMF in more details. So this non-negativity makes the resulting matrices more suitable for clustering of objects and for case scenarios such as recommender systems, where we have a rating scale from 0 to 1. The NMF factorizes matrix A in two matrices, U and V. And the basic property that it requires is the positivity of the values of all those three matrices. There are several ways in which matrices U and V can be computed. For example, we can use the definition of a cost function, which can be minimized either by using multiplicative update rules or additive update rules. In other words, we use a cost function for measuring the divergence between A and the UV product. Here we can see the algorithm of NMF. Since the problem has not an exact solution, in general, the computation of U and V is approximated with numerical methods such as gradient descent or alternating least squares. As shown in this update rule, the gradient descent algorithm always takes a step in the direction of the negative gradient, which is the steepest descending direction of the function. Here, the eta parameter controls the step to the minimum. Please notice that in order to prevent that the values of the matrices U and V become negative, after the application of its update rule in our algorithm, we set any derived negative value of matrices U and V to be equal to 0. We will continue with the CUR decomposition. This decomposition factorizes the matrix A into three matrices, the C, U, and R, which is the name. In high-dimensional data sets, several matrix decomposition algorithms have the drawback that they create the factorized matrices are very dense, like the SVD, where the factorized matrices are very dense. So in such a case, it's very difficult to process their data, and it's a real challenge in terms of efficiency. In contrast, the CUR decomposition method controls this problem, as it decomposes an origin matrix into the C and R matrices, which are really sparse, and only the U matrix is dense, which is quite small. So one quick observation about CUR decomposition method is that the rows and the columns that are used to construct matrices C and R are randomly selected from matrix A. So it is obviously, it is obvious that the selection of these rows and columns will affect the decomposition. So we have to find a way how we will select and pick this row, these rows from matrix A. The fact that we get information from directly columns and rows from matrix A, it means that we can easily interpret the factorization of CUR. So it's good in order to interpret the results.
How is that different than an SVD?
In SVD, we have the factorization in three matrices, U, the S, and the V transpose, whereas the matrices U and V are very dense, become very dense. So it's very difficult to process them in terms of efficiency. Moreover, in these slides, we show how the U matrix is created after the construction of the C and R matrices. First of all, we define a matrix W, and then we find the SVD of W matrix. And finally, matrix U is computed as follows. As it is already told, the CUR method on a sparse matrix A has an advantage over the SVD method, which will be explained later. The two large matrices C and R, which control the sparsity property from the original matrix A, are more sparse, and so they are more easily processable. In terms of matrix decomposition method, there are also other methods which can be referred. For example, the in recommender system area we are talking now. For example, the Goldberg et al., who applied principal component analysis to facilitate online dimensionality reduction for clustering of users and to provide rapid online computation of recommendations. The work of Hoffman, who proposed a model-based algorithm which relies on latent semantic and statistical probabilistic models. The very well-known in the field of recommender system work of Sarwar et al., who was one of the first researchers who applied dimensionality reduction in recommender systems. And of course, the two work that already we have spoken, the SVD++ algorithm, which is the which is proposed from by Gekunda Koren, which is SVD with implicit feedback with additional features, and the timeSVD++, which also incorporates in the model the temporal effects. As far as the SVD method, the singular value decomposition, is a powerful tool of linear algebra that can solve many mathematical problems. As we can see here, the basic idea is the fact that we can remove, by using singular value decomposition, noise from data. So by keeping the principal components here of the basic eigenvalues of matrix A, and keeping the left singular vectors and the right singular vectors of matrix A, we can move from the concepts, from the objects, from the items to concepts. So this is a method which is used in information retrieval, and it's very applicable for the field of recommender systems. Here we can see an example of a user item matrix A, which is decomposed in these three matrices, U, sigma, and V transpose. As I told you before, the V is the orthogonal matrix containing the right singular vectors, the U, the matrix containing the left singular vectors of A, and the S, which is a diagonal matrix containing the singular values of A, eigenvalues. Rho is the rank of matrix A, so the number of linearly independent rows or columns. Of course, this is an approximation, and we can make other approximations by reducing the number of related features, the number of rho in this case. So how SVD is applied in recommendation algorithm? First of all, we apply singular value decomposition. Then we preserve the C number of principal components. We insert the test user in the C-dimensional space that we have created. This was yesterday reported as folding in method, the method that you fold in a test user in the C-dimensional space by Xavier. And the generation of the neighborhood of items and the generation of the recommendation list. To ease our discussion, we will apply the SVD algorithm in our running example. So we have the training and the test data. The null cells are represented as zeros. And let's assume that we want to find the rating of user 4 on over item 1. The first step is to apply SVD on this matrix, on the training data, that produces the decomposition which is shown here of the three matrices. The second step is the preservation of C number of principal components. So here, from a four-dimension problem, we keep only the two dimensions. So we create a two-dimensional latent space. And here we can see that we have to notice that in our running example, we created a two-dimensional space using the 83% of the information of the original matrix. In order to calculate this information, we add the elements of the diagonal of matrix S, and then we keep a percentage of this information, which is here 12.88 to the total of 15.39. This means 83% of the total information of the matrix. The next step is the insertion of the test user in the C-dimensional space. So it is evident that for user-based approach, the test user should be inserted in this space. And this is the process of the folding in a test user, the ratings of a test user in our model. So as we have a new test user with his ratings on items, we have to transform it in our two-dimensional space. This insertion process is not applicable for the case of item-based CF algorithm. We don't need it. And for the afterwards, the fourth step is the generation of the neighborhood of items. For the user-based approach, we find the k-nearest neighbor of a pseudo-user, and these similarities between the training and test set can be based on cosine similarity, for example. And we compute the US matrix, and then we perform vector similarity among rows. This is the way that we compute the cosine similarity of the test user to the other users, and create the the target user's neighborhood. In a similar way, it is done with the item-based approach. So after we create this neighborhood of the target user, then we can generate the recommendation list of items. By following these equations, we can predict the user rating over an item by using his average mean rating and by exploiting the information from the user's neighborhood. This is a target user's neighbor. So we get his, the average of the user's neighborhood. And it is weighted with the similarity of its neighbor of the user. Another very known method, it's the very well-known method, is UV decomposition. UV decomposition is an instance of SVD. The sigma matrix is left-bladed into the feature vector, so the U and V only remain matrices. Here we can see a proof by using the properties of linear regression. So we have the formula of SVD and from linear regression. And as we can see here, we can prove that the sigma matrix, the S matrix here, can be left-bladed to the V, to V matrix. So we can assume that the new matrix V contains both the information of the eigenvalues of the utility matrix A and the information of the right eigenvectors of A. An easy way to estimate the blank zero entries in the user item rating matrix A is to assume that the utility matrix is actually the product of two long thin matrices. As we said before in the two-dimensional diagram with the movies, we can calculate, we can compute the dot product between the users and the items coordinates. So the next step of the method is to find a way to obtain U and V matrices. One way to solve the problem is to initialize the two matrices with some random values and calculate how different is their product compared with A, is their product compared to A. Then we can try to minimize the difference iteratively. Such a numerical approximation method is called gradient descent, aiming to find a local minimum of this of the difference between this, the product of UV and the A matrix. So please notice that we compute here the square error in this shown equation because the predicted rating can be higher or lower than the real rating. In addition, by computing the square of the error, we reward the small errors and we penalize the big ones. So in this slide, we formulate the objective function and present the additive update rules. We will present the additive update rules in the next slide. We present the partial derivatives of U matrix. The challenge is to minimize the error among the real and the predicted values. Since there is no closed form solution for function G, we use a numerical approximation method such as gradient descent. In particular, to minimize the error function, we have to know in which direction to move to modify the values of UIK and VKJ elements. Thus, to minimize the error function, the partial derivatives of G with respect to U and V should be computed. So here we see the partial derivative of U, and the same we have to do with the partial derivative with respect to V. And based on this information, then we can have the objective function and the gradients and the two update, additive update rules, one for the U matrix and one for the V element. Having obtained the gradients from the previous slide, we can now formulate the additive update rules for UIK and for VKJ. Here, eta the eta parameters also is a constant that we set. It is user defined, and we determine the rate of approaching the minimum. Usually, we will choose a small step value for such a parameter, which is 0.002. The reason to be small value is that if we make a large step towards the minimum, we may run into the risk of missing it and oscillating around the minimum. A common problem in prediction modeling is overfitting. So the overfitting problem occurs when a model begins to memorize training data rather than generalizing from training data. In our case, in the UV decomposition, we can avoid overfitting by adding a new parameter beta. Which controls the magnitudes of the user feature and the item feature vectors. In particular, it downsizes the possible large number values of one vector so that they cannot dominate the values of the other, of the possible smaller number values of the other vector. So let's see an example of this UV decomposition. We are using again our running example. As it is shown in this slide, we decompose the A matrix in two matrices, the U and V matrix. We have to initialize and we have to arbitrarily choose the initial values for U and V. Here, we set them their values with ones. So this means that we create a two-dimensional feature space and K is equal to 2. UV decomposition starts with some arbitrarily chosen U and V and then repeatedly adjusts U and V to decrease the root mean square error, this formula. To decrease the RMSE of our objective function, incrementally we can make adjustments to each separate element of U and V. So in our running example, we adjust the element of U11 by setting it with the X variable. And we want to find the value that of those entries that give the largest possible improvement to the RMSE. We want to minimize RMSE, which is the actual distance of the original values to the predicted one values. So having the matrix of the previous slide, as the starting point of UV decomposition, we initially change the value of element U11 of matrix U. And as you can see here, the only change that we get in terms of RMSE can be given from the first row only. And we want to find the value of X that minimizes the RMSE. And we want to find the value that minimizes the sum of the first row. So we have this equation, and we want to find the x variable, value for the x variable. We take the derivative of this equation and then equal to 0. And we find that the x value is 1.5. We set it in this U11 element of matrix U, and then we can compute the new approximated matrix A, the A hat. So we have a new values for the entries of the first row. As you can see here, the new RMSE is lower than the previous RMSE. So we have decreased, and we are moving to the minimum. So this is the first step. And this algorithm, the UV decomposition algorithm, iteratively moves and finds a minimum. It does not guarantee the fact that you will find the total minimum, maybe a local minimum, and this, please keep it in your mind. Moreover, as I told you before, in a UV decomposition method, we can add additional information. Let's assume, in our case example, that we have the friendship information, the friendship network. So this is represented with a user-user matrix, friendship matrix. And we want this information to inject into our model. This is the adjacency matrix F. So we have to add the constraint of friendship, which is applied only on the user matrix and the user feature matrix. The new constraint places the restriction that a user should rate similarly with his friends. So in other words, we take the difference between the rating of a value of the target user and the mean of ratings of all the target user's friends. Here, we have the rating of a target user and the mean of ratings of his friends. Parameter gamma controls the weight we want to give in this friendship information. So it takes values from 0 to 1. And the T is the number of users who are friends of user, of the target user. And parameter gamma controls, as I told you, how much the friendship influences the prediction. So by setting this new information in our objective equation, objective in our cost function, we have to update to find out the partial derivatives and conclude to the new additive update rules. So here are the new update rules of this equation. And here we can see the full algorithm, pseudocode algorithm of the UDV decomposition algorithm. We have the user item rating matrix A, we have the user-user adjacency matrix F, the parameter K, which controls the U and V matrices, the parameter eta, which is controls the step size in the direction of the negative gradient. And the first 10 lines are for the initialization. And then, as you can see, from lines 12 to 16, we have this repetition where we calculate the old based on the old value of UI and VI gradients, respectively, and make a step in the direction of the negative gradient of G. This process will be repeatedly executed until the error between the real and the predicted values of matrix A hat and A ceases to improve, or a maximum number of iterations reached is reached, which is line 16. So in line 17, we take the product of the computed matrices, which produce the final prediction rated matrix A. Some programming hints for running faster your algorithm. For the representation of data, this slides we show you with matrix representation, but in terms of programming, we have to use linked lists. In the level of language, we have to use a low-level language, such as C++ instead of others, which maybe we can face severe latency. We have to use, it would be good to use the command concurrency parallel for of the C++ instead of the command for to exploit all processors' cores. So we can make it really running really fast, this algorithm. and use the command concurrency combinable variable to add the results of each different thread. So this is a code example of the algorithm and how the update rules are get updated. Let's see some experiments on matrix decomposition methods. We have two data sets, the opinions data set, which consists of 130,000 users and 800,000 items, and the geosocial rec data set, which is a location-based social network. And we have three algorithms, the UV decomposition, the SVD, and the CUR algorithm. Let's see how we have to make the sensitivity analysis of UV decomposition, because it is very important the good tuning of the K parameters we have told previously. The tuning of the K latent feature space. In the opinions, as we can see, the best value is get when we set K equal to 16. I remind you that the K parameters is the number of the latent features, which means that we keep both matrices thin. If this K parameter is small, then we keep these matrices thin. And so the required storage is small. As you can see in the second data set, this K parameter is different. The best RMSE value we get with when K is equal to 2, here. So for each different data set, we have different tuning of this K parameter, and we will get the best values after a very good tuning. It depends on the data sparseness. It depends on other factors. Moreover, we have to tune the parameter beta. Parameter beta is the one that handles the problem of overfitting. So it controls the magnitudes of item-related features. As you can see here, parameter beta is very important for the opinions dataset. So we can, by tuning the parameter beta, we can decrease the RMSE, we get better results, but this is not shown drastically in the geosocial rec dataset. This means that here we have more training data, so the problem of overfitting is more severe in this case. So beta parameter is very important to be well tuned. Another measure that is the RMSE. Of course, we can see in all three methods that UV decomposition algorithm outperforms the other methods, the SVD and the CUR. In general, the UV decomposition and the SVD are get better results than CUR. And in terms of precision and recall diagram, the results expected, all algorithms precision falls as the top n recommendation increases. So here we have the top one recommendation, top two, and the top 10 recommended item in this data set. So as this number of top n recommendation increases, we can see that precision decreases and recall increases. Okay, which is what we expect as a behavior from for a precision recall curve. In conclusion, we can say that good results on RMSE may not fully characterize the user's experience in web-based recommender systems. The basic reason is that an error of size E has the same impact on RMSC, regardless of where that error places the item in the top N ranking. Of course, UV decomposition is a powerful tool for factorizing matrices. And we can use additional information which can be added easily in the objective function. So as you can see, the basic method is SVD, and we have the SVD++ proposed by Yekunda Koren, which adds implicit feedback. The fact that we don't see only the ratings of in the user rating matrix, but also we see if someone has rated or not a product. This is the implicit feedback. So we put it inside our formula, and we have the time SVD++, which is a method that uses temporal effects. The time dimension is taken under consideration in the model. So I think that it is very important when we make experiments and we want to test our method, in terms of matrix factorization at least, we have to see these methods. The SVD++ and the time SVD++ should be a competitor in our case, because are the state of the art the last years. I read the literature, and there are very strong algorithms to be beaten. So we will proceed with tensors. As I told you before, the tensors can handle the high-order problems. Here we can see an example of a tensor with the IJ with three dimensions, which suits very well to the social tagging systems, because in the social tagging systems we have three participating entities: the users, the items, and the tags. So the dimension one has the users. Dimension 2 has the J items, holds J items, and dimension 3 has K tags. And the element XIKJ, A XIJK, means that user I tagged the item J with the tag K. Of course, in tensors we have basic algebraic operations, and the notion of fiber is the higher order analog of use of rows and columns in a matrix. So we have three modes. We have the column fibers, mode 1, the row fibers, mode 2, and the tube fibers, mode 3. A fiber is defined by setting a value to all indices except one. So here we set these values 5 and 1 except the first, and we set the fiber in mode 1. The way that we stack these fibers, one after the other, creates the three modes of unfolding a tensor. So here we can see three types of tensor unfoldings. The tensor unfolding is what we say matricization, the fact that we transform a tensor into a matrix. We have a unfolding in the mode 1 unfolding here. So this tensor becomes this matrix. We have the unfolding of tensor in the second mode, and the unfolding of tensor in the third mode. And all this happens based on how these fibers are stacked one other after the other. Other type of algebraic operations that we can have is the multiplication of a tensor with a matrix. So here we can see with the calligraphic, we denote the tensors. And so here we multiply a tensor with the matrix B. And this multiplication is done in the second mode. The second mode means that we multiply the lateral slices of the tensor with a matrix B. The result of this product is again a tensor. So we have three types of product tensor by matrix multiplication. The first is mode one multiplication, the frontal slices. The second is mode two multiplication, the lateral slices. And the third is mode three multiplication, the horizontal slices. Based on these algebraic operations, we have the well-known method, which is the Tucker decomposition, TD decomposition of a tensor. Here we can see a tensor which is represents a problem in social tagging recommender systems. So we have the user, the location, and the tag. The A is the calligraphic and is a tensor. So this tensor is factorized based on the Tucker algorithm, which is proposed in 1966 in three matrices, 1, 2, 3, the U, T, and L matrix, and the core tensor S. It's very similar to the idea of SVD, but in terms of a higher order. So the basic idea is to cast the recommendation problem as a third order tensor completion problem by completing the non-observed entries in a tensor. And given a tensor A with these three dimensions, and given the size of the core tensor S, which is user-defined, so the user or the algorithm has to decide for these three values, the dimension of key U, the dimension of KL, and the dimension of KT. And given this, these two things, then we can produce an approximation tensor A by taking the multiplying the core tensor S in the first mode with matrix 2, in the second mode with matrix L, and in the third mode with matrix T. Since there is no closed form solution for A hat, the predicted tensor, we can solve it with numerical methods. So we can use the alternative least squares or the gradient descent method. So we can solve it as an optimization-based model. And here we want to minimize the element-wise square loss between the real and the predicted values. And when this optimized parameter is found, an element of A hat tensor is computed as follows. So an important thing is the dimensions that these three values, these variables take, which expresses the latent feature space of these three dimensions, the users, the items, and the tags. This algorithm, this method, is known as truncated higher-order SVD. This is not guarantees an optimal solution, but it is a good starting point for an iterative alternating least squares algorithm to best fit the reconstructed tensor to the original one. So here we can see how an alternating least squares algorithm can have as input the tensor that we get from the truncated higher order SVD, having the initial core tensor, and how we can, with a repetition until our objective function ceases to improve, and to the original values of, or a maximum iterations, number of iterations is reached. Again, here, the basic idea of HOSVD tries to minimize the error between the trial, the initial and the predicted values of the tensor. Please notice that the values of the leading left singular vectors in all three modes increases gradually in each iteration. So here, in each iteration, these numbers increases. So we increase the number of the k-related feature in each iteration. Let's see an overview of the truncated higher order SVD algorithm. First, we build the tensor A. We make the three unfoldings in the first mode, the second mode, and the third mode. This is called also matricization of a tensor. And then we apply SVD in each mode. So we have to apply three times SVD for the first mode, for the second mode, and the third mode. And for each SVD, we have to keep the K rank of each mode. And we then build the core tensor S. And finally, based on the core tensor S, we build the final approximation tensor A hat. So let's see an example. In this slide, we illustrate how high order SVD is applied for item recommendation and how it works. We apply higher order SVD on this toy example, which consists of three types of entities: the users, the locations, and the tags. So user one tagged item one, the L1 location is here in our example, with a tag ringing. As we can see here, the users U1 and U2 has a preference on the Piccadilly bar, while the user three is interested in studying the library. So let's see how this can be represented with the tensor and if we can find some related associations among these participating entities. The first thing is to put the data inside the tensor. So we construct this three-order tensor and we use the co-occurrence frequency as of its triplet user, location, and activity as the element of a tensor. The second step is that we compute the three matrix unfoldings. The unfolding in the first mode by putting the fibers the one after the other. The matrix in the second mode and the matrix in the third mode. Then we have to apply SVD in each mode. In each matrix of these three matrices, we show only for the first one, the matrix in the first mode. We apply the SVD, and we have the three matrices U, S, and V transpose. And afterwards, we keep the most important singular values of each matrix. So here, in the dimension of users, from the three users, we create a two-dimensional space for our case, in our example. The other two modes have no reduce. And we build the final tensor A hat. We construct the core tensor S that reduces the dimensionality by applying this equation. And finally, based on the S core tensor, we can calculate the A hat tensor. So, what has happened? We have the three users, we have the locations, and the activities that they have performed. As we can see here in the new process data, and you can test it in a MATLAB for these results and verify yourself. The new association has revealed the fact that U1, the element U1, L2, and tag 2 is 0.44. What does this mean? It means that if we were asked to recommend to user 1 a location for activity 2, then we could recommend him location L2 based on this found information. Please notice that this indication was not existed in the original tensor. So this is an example of how tensors can be used to reveal latent associations among entities. Of course, the higher order SVD method has bottlenecks and mostly are computational drawbacks. So the tensors may be very sparse. And the tensors may have dimensions with many instances and thousands. We can have dimensions with thousands of tags, a dimension with millions of users, etc. So how can we handle this sparsity and scalability problem? And how these problems can affect the efficiency of the higher order SVD? How can we deal with this problem? There are some solutions which will be now presented to you. The first that someone could do is to perform a kind of pre-clustering of these dimensions, for example, to decrease the size of its dimension. One such method is proposed in 2016, which is known as classed HOSVD. And classed HOSVD introduces an effective pre-processing step, the clustering of tags that can reduce the size of the tensor dimensions and deal with its missing values. So to perform clustering of tags, the classed HOSVD incorporates into its model two different similarity measures. The first is the similarity between tags based on the words and based on the TF-IDF weighting schema with a vector space model. The second is to address polysemy and synonymity of tags, which computes also the semantic ambiguity between tags by utilizing the WordNet dictionary. So after performing this tag clustering, we use these centroids of the cluster tags, of the found cluster tags, for the representation of the tensor. Thus, we efficiently overcome the tensor the computational bottleneck by reducing both the factorization dimension and the data sparsity. Other method is the non-parafact method, the parallel factor analysis, which reduces the complexity of the Tensor decomposition or high order SVD by assuming only a diagonal tensor. So this assumption of a diagonal core tensor can be considered as a restriction of the Tensor decomposition model. This means that any parafact model can be expressed by a Tensor decomposition model, but any decomposition model cannot be represented with a parafact model. So, however, we have to point out that this does not mean that Tensor decomposition is always better than can guarantee higher prediction than the parafact. Other methods. Method which is known as PCLAF, Personalized Collaborative Location and Activity Filtering, which is proposed by Zeng et al. The novelty of PCLAF lays on the utilization of this user activity location matrix along with other matrices, with the user-user, the user location, the location features, and the activities. So the PCLAF aims to complete the missing entries of the tensor A by firstly decomposing the tensor A, and then by forcing the related factors to be shared with the additional matrices to utilize their information. So we can see here the objective function which is proposed by PCLAF. And based on the shown objective function, PCLAF wants to minimize the error between the real and the predicted values of the reconstructed tensor. Another algorithm proposed by the same research team, the research team of Zeng et al., is known as the RPCLAF. This changes a little bit the notion of the problem. It does not try to complete the entries of the tensor, but it solves it as a recommendation problem by using a ranking loss objective function. So the RPCLAF uses the location activity pairwise preferences by using the shown equation. This distinguishes between positive and negative location activity pairwise preferences. And also we have the missing values and the values that are zero. Observed location activity pairwise preferences are interpreted as positive feedback, whereas the non-observed location activity pairwise preferences are negative evidence. So let's see an example here. The left-hand side figure shows the tensor representation as we have seen till now, where the positive feedback is a positive entry with one and the other are zeros. The RPCLAF now changes the problem and it makes it pairwise location activity preference, a pairwise location activity preference. So the right-hand side of this slide shows the tensor representation of the RPCLAF, where the observed location activity pairwise preference is considered as positive feedback here, in contrast to the other value which is not observed and it is as considered as negative feedback. All the other entries are either missing or are zero values. So, in terms of tensor decomposition methods, we have other methods also, like the ranking with tensor factorization algorithm, which is proposed for, by Rendl et al., KDT 2008, which is almost similar with the idea of the concept of RPCLAF. We have the pairwise interaction tensor factorization, from the same author and the co-authors, the PITF algorithm is a special case of the. Excuse me. The PITF algorithm is a special case of the Tucker decomposition model, with a linear runtime both for learning and prediction. And PITF explicitly models the pairwise interactions between user item attacks instead of ternary ones. So it downsizes the problem from a ternary relation to pairwise interactions. Second order. Let's see some experiments on tensor factorization methods. We will see two data sets, the Bibsonomy and the LastFM. Of course, they are three-order problems, users, items, in the first case, and tags, and in the second, user, artists, and tags. we have four algorithms to compare, the class HOSVD, the TFC model, the higher order SVD, and the LOTD, which is a method that consists of low-order polynomials. And the metrics are precision and recall. First of all, let's see how high-order SVD demands also a well-tuning of the K parameters. So here we can see that we keep one dimension of the core tensor fixed, and we see how the recommendation accuracy varies as we vary the values of the other two dimensions. The vertical axis denotes the precision, and the other two axes denote the corresponding dimensions. So for each figure, one dimension is fixed and the other two dimensions are varied. Thus, for the leftmost figure, the tag dimension is fixed at 200, and the other two dimensions change. For the middle figure, the item dimension is fixed to 105, and for the last is fixed to 66. So this can be done very handily by a hardwired way, so changes the values of these parameters. But it can be handled very easily based on the alternative least squares algorithm. Okay. We also see some results in terms of precision and recall diagram on the dipsonomy, and where we can see the performance of these algorithms. And the class HOSVD method outperforms the other methods since it incorporates in the model also semantic information based on the WordNet network. Well, there are, of course, challenging issues for the tensors. For example, how can we update a tensor decomposition? Because this model has been done mostly offline. So if we have a website that we want to, new users are add on, and we have to put them inside the latent space model, space, how is this done? As we've seen in the previous slides, one method is folding in. Okay, which incrementally updates SVD. But the resulting model is not a perfect SVD model because after the folding in of some users, it may be the space will not be orthogonal. So if the update size is big, then we have may lose the orthogonality, which means that we will have an inaccurate SVD model. So in case of big data, the update of many entries, we need to incrementally update HOSVD. And this can be updated by method which is proposed by Matthew Brandt, and it is named as incremental update of the tensor. So the idea here is if we have our running example, how can we insert new entries and update the SVD online? And let's assume that someone is inserted in our system. So we have a user with these three ratings. And we, based on the method proposed by Matthew, we can create a mixed matrix by our previous SVD, and the left and right matrices are unitary and orthogonal. The middle matrix should be diagonalized to update the SVD and run in this mixed matrix the new SVD. So I don't want to be so detailed in this method, but it's something that it is tested and it is it runs. So the update can be the new insertion can be made in our data. Let's see other directions and other issues that have to do with tensors. So one problem is the fact that a tensor may be too large to fit in memory. How can we deal with this? There are some solutions which are proposed. The first thing is that we can load in memory only one slice of a tensor at a time. So these are two methods which are known, the slice projection algorithm and the multi-slice projection algorithm. There are other proposals for fast computation of tensors. I would recommend you as a beginning in your research to start using the tensor, the MATLAB toolbox for running tensors, which is proposed by Bader and Kolda. And can handle tensors in the size of thousands well. Okay, but not more than thousands. And if you want to handle tensors with hundreds of thousands as instances in each dimension, then I would recommend to run a tensor on top of a Hadoop. And one nice algorithm which is proposed is FlexiFact, proposed by Boitel et al. And FlexiFact performs decomposition of tensor through careful partitioning and parallelization of processing the data, and how this data can scale very well for big data and for millions of billions of parameters. So I have almost finished my talk. We can have some question if you want to be answered. And there is, for the case of having some time, I can show you some case studies, like the MUCREC project, which is which is based on the matrix factorization model, and we can see how this case study implements matrix factorization. So thank you, and if you have any questions, I would be glad to answer. Yes.
You've suggested using gradient descent, and how sensitive are these to starting values? So, do we have to worry about going into a local minima, or in practice is that not really an issue?
Well, in terms of the initial values, usually they are randomly selected in the range of the ratings of that we have. If we have a rating scale 0 to 5, then we can randomly choose any value in this range. I think that the algorithm can converge after some iterations. But in our case, for our experiments that I showed you here, the algorithm's maximum number of iterations is 5,000. So you need some time in order to get the convergence.
Thank you for your presentation. It's very helpful. Will you make your slides available, or are the slides available, or by the book?
Well, it is very bad the fact that I couldn't deliver here the book. I was trying to with the Springer to get it with me here and have a look at it. Most of the material is taken from the book. But I believe that after a time period of some months, I will also upload the PowerPoint slides. Yeah. Yeah. Well, for the remaining time, the MUCREC is a matrix-based prototype recommender system. In this website, it's a commercial website, MUCREC.com, we recommend MOOCs to users. We want to extract some information from the user, so we ask some of their basic studies, and then we take their ideal job, and then we're trying to find suitable courses that can be recommended to them. So the main architecture of this website consists of these four elements. The first element is the web crawler. We crawl information from LinkedIn, which is very difficult because it's just stops you after the process of 20 users. We also, from LinkedIn, we get the job description and we get also the skills of each user. We also take information from the EDX and the Coursera. It's in our database, there are almost 1,200 courses. And we put them in the matrix factorization, as I will show you the equation, and make it offline processing once a week. And let's see some matrices. The first basic matrix that we use is the user courses matrix. The users, as they interact with our website, we have their how many times they have processed a specific course. We know, for example, if they leave our website and went to the platform like EDX or Coursera, and all this is the utility matrix. We keep this information and we will process it. This will be the main matrix that we will create the UV decomposition. The plain UV decomposition that I described to you will be done only on this matrix. All the other information is additional information that we get. Well, the additional information is the courses and the words that they have. From each course, we take the short description and the name of the course, and we make a TF-IDF model and a vector space model, and put this information inside a matrix, the W matrix. So we have created a prediction formula. This prediction equation consists of the global mean value of preferences, the biases of user and course. This is very similar to the one proposed by implicit feedback of Yehuda Koren. But in our case, we have the P, the U and V matrices. Now it is named as P and Q. In our case, we put implicit feedback from the user skills and from the course skills, how they are related, the courses with skills, because each course has specific words that are related with the job description, so the skills that are needed for getting a job. So this is the prediction formula. And we compute the objective. We have the objective function. We compute the gradients. And we perform afterwards the matrix factorization. So I can show you the objective function now with the biases for users and the course, the mean value, the basic matrices P and Q, which come from the user courses matrix, the additional information we get from the course user skills and the courses skills matrices. And here you can see the regularization we have incorporated in order to avoid overfitting. Okay, and based on this objective function, we have computed the gradients in order to perform the repetition and find the additive update rules for minimizing the random mean square of the previous cost function. As a last piece of information, this website is at 6 months on web, and we have about 300 users registered. These users can, if they are interested in MOOCs, they can make some kind of registration, get alerts in case that a new MOOC is appeared and starts in the next week, for example. Here we can see the total number of views, the recommendation that have been clicked, okay, which is a really interesting thing because you can have an idea of the click-through rate. It is recommended, and it is clicked by the user. And this is an important measure, the number of exceeded MOOC users after having seen a MOOC description. So many users, after having taken a specific recommendation, go to the platform. So leave our website and go to the platform. And this is some numbers I would like very much to know from the companies like Netflix or Quora that I have seen their talks during the previous days. Because if you know the CTR of your recommendation, then you can have an idea of if your algorithm is good or not. For example, your algorithm in 2013 has this kind of CTR, and after 2 years, how much is this CTR, the click-through rate, the clicks per views of a recommendation? So this is all. Thank you very much for your presence here and your patience.